So as part of the session, I'm planning to cover the role of integration in the microservices and cloud native architecture, and also some of the microservices integration patterns, how existing integration patterns are transforming into these cloud native and microservices architectures. And also, during the latter part of the session, I'll briefly talk about how WSO2 integration platform can be leveraged to build some of these patterns. Okay, so let's get started. So as you know, digital transformation is inevitable, right? As any enterprise has to convert their existing enterprise into a digitally transformed enterprise. And integration plays a major role there, because at the end of the day, as part of your digital transformation, you'll be integrating your existing APIs, services, data, files, whatever. So it's the foundation of digital transformation is the integration. And for digital transformation, how do we adapt this cloud native or microservices architecture, right? So before going into those details, let's have a look at what is cloud native. So if I ask you what is cloud native, what would be your answer, right? So this gives like a high level definition. It's a methodology for building and running software applications by leveraging the full power of cloud computing. Right? It's very, very abstract definition, right? So let's have a look at some of the key attributes of cloud-native applications. So as part of the cloud-native application development, the first step is to identify your business capabilities, right? So once you identify your business capabilities, then you will build microservices or serverless functions as the realization of those capabilities. So the second step is, once you build those services or functions, then you package them into containers, right? So this is where Docker and container orchestration systems such as Kubernetes coming into the picture. So once you package them, then you build a continuous delivery model. So that means you can streamline the development of a feature, you can streamline the application of a given capability from your dev environment to production. So you will cover all the QA testing and all the life cycle of a given feature or an enhancement. So once you have a proper continuous delivery pipeline, then the next step is the governance. So I use the term the adaptive governance. So for example, let's say you build an application and deploy that into production, and you need to scale that up or scale that down based on your incoming traffic. So that is adaptive. And also building an observability ecosystem, like monitoring, tracing, logging for your production application is also a key requirement. So that is fully covered with this adaptive governance concept. So those are the key steps involved in building a cloud-native application. Okay, so now cloud-native applications are basically it's on the rise, right? So we used to have this kind of API-driven architecture. Now we are segregating them further into microservices and serverless function. So that means what you are basically doing as part of these cloud-native applications is your capabilities are segregated across the network, right? So you have a lot of capabilities which are dispersed across the network, and they are connected over the network calls. So that's why the integration of cloud-native application is becoming more important. Now you have to deal with not three or four services, but maybe hundreds of services. Therefore, integration of those network segregated components or services is absolutely essential. Now, we used to integrate all these systems or services or data with the use of a central ESP. Right? So with the cloud native and microservices architecture, we are promoting the disaggregated nature of integration, which means you eliminate the central ESP and you build your integration in a decentralized way. So what this means is, now this is the ESP driven architecture, right? So where you have set of services, data, files, MQ, and all those things are interconnected with the use of a central ESP. So So as part of the ESB layer, we have applied business capabilities. All the compositions are part of your business capabilities. So those virtual services are actually doing that. And also network resiliency and inter-service communication resiliency. Things such as circuit breaking, retries, timeouts. So those things are also applied at the ESB layer. In addition to that, you have things such as all the cross-cutting concerns, security, observability. All those things are applied at the central ESB layer. Now, with the microservices architecture, we are promoting, we are fostering the elimination of the ESB and introducing a disaggregated integration services. Now, the requirements are still the same. You have a set of microservices, and they are communicating with each other. And we can come up with this kind of a aggregated architecture, where you have set of services, more or less autonomous services, and there are composite services. So this communication can either be synchronous, asynchronous, event-driven. So any types of communications can be used. But the important aspect is all the things that you used to do with this architecture has to be facilitated in this architecture as well. Right? So with the polyglot nature of microservices, you will be developing different types of microservices using different technologies. That means those capabilities that you used to build, that you used to get out of the box with ESB now has to be done as part of these services. So that is the main challenge in realizing microservices integration. Now, if we look at, before going into the integration patterns related to microservices, let's have a look at some of the anti-patterns. So this is actually from 2016. So Netflix, they initially built their microservices architecture, and they come up with hundreds of services. And when it comes to creating compositions or the orchestrations between these services, they initially built all those orchestration at the API gateway layer. So that means the business logic of the composition residing at the API gateway layer, and they had a single monolithic gateway layer. So virtually, this is the ESB they are using, right? So they have renamed ESB into a API gateway. So that's an anti-pattern, and later they realized that this is not going to work, and you can find more details in this blog post. Later, they segregated API gateway layer as well. So this is an anti-pattern that we should avoid at all cost. And also integrating with a central ESB. So basically what you can do is you can put an ESB at this layer and integrate them, which is again an anti-pattern. Okay, so how do we integrate these services? So as part of the integration patterns, I'll have a look at two main patterns. So this is active compositions or orchestration pattern. So primarily, this pattern is based on synchronous communication, request-response style communication. So here we can identify several types of services. So these services at the bottom, like the core services, they are having very less network interaction. They are more or less focused on computation, data, with less network interactions. And on top of that, you have these composite services, the services that are offering composite business capabilities. So basically, if you take this microservice at the middle, it is calling three different other services, right? And once you build those composite services, then you have to expose those capabilities to your external parties, to your customers, partners, or within the organization, you want to expose those capabilities in a managed way. So that's where API management comes into the picture. Again, we don't expose all those APIs in a single monolithic gateway. Rather, we segregate all those APIs into independent runtimes, which are micro gateways, independent runtimes, which are centrally managed, centrally governed. So the governance aspect is actually provided from the API management the portal, the publisher aspect, which is a central component, and all the gateway components are micro components, which can have their own independent deployment and scaling life cycles. So this is the high-level architecture of synchronous integration, and of course you will be integrating with your existing systems, right? All the proprietary and all the existing ESBs can be used along with this architecture. Okay, now let's have a look at some of the most commonly used protocols to facilitate this architecture. So obviously, as part of the de facto standard for building microservices, the RESTful services is the most commonly used one. But what we are seeing is we more or less moving away from REST services to other protocols during last year or so. So that's where gRPC, in particularly for internal microservices communication, for not for the services that we are exposing to the external parties, but for internal communication, gRPC is becoming really popular. And also GraphQL, again, in this architecture for services that we are exposing to external parties, GraphQL is a great way to do that. Because you don't really have to follow the conventional RESTful resource-oriented architecture, but you can make your APIs more interactive and more flexible with GraphQL. And also other protocols such as RSocket is getting some traction. It's quite similar to gRPC, but well-suited for, again, for internal communication. WebSocket, Thrift, some other conventional protocols for realizing this request-response style communication. Okay, so the second pattern is reactive composition. In this case, or we can call it choreography pattern as well. So in this case, unlike the previous one, we don't have direct service-to-service communication. All the communication has taken place over an event bus. So, for example, there can be a producer services, there can be consumer services. So all the communication is taken place over this event bus using PubSub or single consumer or multiple consumer messaging. Now, so obviously, as part of the event bus implementation, you can use any message broker technology, such as Kafka, AMQP. So those brokers are good candidate to implement the event bus. But the important aspect of this event bus architecture is we used to have a lot of business capabilities as part of these message broker products, right? So the best practice is to put as less capabilities as possible in the event bus and have all the business capabilities as part of your service. So that's where technologies such as Kafka is becoming so popular when it comes to implementing this, because Kafka is a dumb broker, right? So you are putting a message and you are getting a binary message back. You don't have much of a routing logic inside Kafka. You have the control, the producer and the consumer have a lot of control over messaging. So that's why Kafka is becoming so popular. Okay, so and if you look at some of the technologies that are available for implementing this, we have Kafka, AMQP for certain, mostly for guaranteed delivery scenarios, AMQP is a good candidate. And also there are a lot of cloud-based eventing solutions. NATS is also becoming really popular, which is a CNCF technology. Cloud events actually describe specification to define your events. So again, a lot of traction on cloud events. JMS is, again, a possible technology, but not getting that popular, though. All right, so how to choose active or reactive composition? So there was a lot of discussion on your microservices architecture has to be always reactive, right? Which is not true. So my recommendation is that there are certain scenarios that you need active compositions. In particular, if you are designing an API, it is always good to have RESTful or GraphQL type interactions, the services that you are exposing to your external consumers. And one of the disadvantages of active composition is that there are service interdependencies, right? So your composite service is actually dependent on the downstream services, so that's a problem, right? If there's an outage of your downstream service, that will affect the composite service as well. And reactive composition is ideal for asynchronous interactions, such as order placing, order processing, things that you can do in asynchronous way. And one problem of this kind of choreography or asynchronous integration is that the composition logic is actually dispersed across the network. So with the composite services, with the synchronous style, you can go to a particular service and identify the business logic, because the orchestration logic is part of that service. But with the reactive model, it always communicates with PubSub, right? That means the communication logic is dispersed across the network. So you need to have a fully-fledged observability ecosystem behind your reactive architecture. So based on those, based on your requirement, what we can recommend is a hybrid approach, which means most of the services that you are going to expose to the external parties can use active composition, whereas most of the internal communication that can be implemented with event-based architecture. And also, you can mix and match all the different technologies that we talk about. For example, REST, HTTP for HTTP and GraphQL for APIs, internal communication with gRPC, Kafka, or any other event-based system for asynchronous communication. OK, so we talk about all the greenfield stuff, right? But most of the enterprises are not in this state. Right? You have a lot of existing integration products, a lot of ESBs, a lot of integration suites. So there are a couple of patterns that are commonly used in transforming your existing architecture to this cloud-native architecture. So the anti-corruption layer pattern is mainly used to bridge your, let's say, conventional and your cloud-native systems. So the main idea behind this pattern is that you build an anti-corruption layer so that these two systems can, two architecture can coexist, and you don't have to change one system in order to support the other system. So all the transformations, all kind of protocol switching has to be done at this layer. Oh, okay, and strangler pattern is also another commonly used, I would say, strategy, so that you can start building a new project. Let's say you have an existing legacy system, and you are building your new project with all the, these cloud-native technologies, and you put a strangler facade, which will do routing between these two systems, and you will gradually convert this legacy architecture into a modern and fully transformed to the modern architecture, right? So again, both existing architecture and new architecture can coexist with this strategy. Okay, so let's try to map these patterns, map how WSO2 can be used to implement these patterns, right? So obviously, let's start with the conventional integration stuff. So that's where our WSO2 Enterprise Integrator is a good fit. So that that is the monolithic integration unit. And when it comes to building these kind of composite integrations, we have two options. So Ballerina is obviously the programming language that is designed for doing this kind of integration. So that's an option. And also, if you are already using ESBs, WSO2 ESB, and you want to use it in a cloud-native environment, such as Docker or Kubernetes, we have the micro ESB option, so which uses the pretty much the same configuration, same runtime, but in more cloud-native friendly manner. And if you compare Ballerina versus micro ESBs, two computing technologies, but two different approaches. So micro ESB is actually built around the existing configuration language, which is a domain-specific language. It has it's fully configuration-driven, whereas Ballerina is a programming language, right? So you can pick and choose between those two technologies. And also, as part of the API services layer, you have API management and identity server, which can which also can work as a monolithic gateway as well as the microservices micro gateway. Okay, so any talk on integration is not complete without talking about service mesh nowadays, right? So I'm sure most of you have heard of service mesh. which is an emerging concept, especially in the cloud-native architecture era. So the main idea behind, the main motivation behind service mesh is the problem that we just talked about, right? So you had the central ESP, and when you segregate that into independent services, there are a lot of features that you have to build as part of your services logic. So that means, let's say you want to build service-to-service communication and you want to have some kind of a resiliency mechanism, such as circuit breaking, right? So that means you have to build that capability as part of your services code. That's where all the libraries, such as Hystrix, has to be used to build microservices. So there are a whole lot of such commodity features which are not directly related to your business logic. Right? Circuit breaker is not part of your business logic. Observability is not part of your business logic. Security, MTLS is not part of your business logic. So what service mesh architecture fosters is you have your service, microservice, which only contains your business logic, and you offload them, offload the all the other commodity features to a co-located sidecar. It's co-located in your VM, in your Kubernetes pod. So this is a one component, but fully disconnected components. So, and if you look at the structure of your microservices, now you have the business logic and some primitive network function, which only can call the sidecar, and sidecar is taken care of doing all the network communication. So this is where you implement all the circuit breaking, all the service-to-service communication logic. And all these sidecars are actually controlled by a central control plane, so which can be considered as the governance layer, where you can push all your routing logic and security policies, etc. So the best practices of using service mesh, this is still yet to be fully tested in production. This is a very new architecture, and there are a few production use cases, but still pretty new to be tested across the world. So there are a few guidelines when you are using service mesh. So the first thing is you shouldn't put any business logic into these sidecars, right? Although it may provide some capabilities, you shouldn't put any business logic related capabilities. And you can use that for all the inter-service communication resiliency as well as the governance. And also, there are limitations with the current service mesh implementation, such as TO and Linkerd, that they only support asynchronous communication because they are built around the sidecar proxy concept. Therefore, it more or less supports the synchronous communication. So there are some ongoing work putting Kafka support for and more, et cetera, but if you are using this kind of hybrid architecture, basically you have to implement the synchronous part with service mesh and doing the asynchronous part outside the service mesh. All right, so I think we covered quite a few areas related to cloud native and microservices integration. So as a conclusion, cloud-native shift is inevitable. Docker and Kubernetes is, if you are not using it, you might have to use it in near future. So you have to be prepared for this cloud-native shift. And also, adaptive and iterative approach for integration is required, right? You are not completely throw away your existing integration technologies. You will have to use them alongside all the new technologies. And hybrid pattern is actually quite useful when you are, using inter-service communication technologies. All right, so any questions on this? And some of the details are available in my book, so I co-authored with Prabhat, which will be out in this November. It's a generic book, so it's not just about WSO2.